Chapter 6 of Plunkitt of Tammany Hall, a series of very plain talks on very practical politics. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain, recording by Mike Vendetti. Plunkitt of Tammany Hall, a series of very plain talks on very practical politics, by George Washington Plunkitt. Chapter 6. To hold your district. Study human nature and act accordin'. There's only one way to hold a district. You must study human nature and act accordin'. You can't study human nature in books. Books is a hindrance more than anything else. If you have been to college, so much the worse for you. You'll have to unlearn all you learn before you can get right down to human nature. And unlearning takes a lot of time. Some men can never forget what they learned at college. Such men may get to be district leaders by a fluke, but they never last. To learn real human nature, you have to go among the people, see them, and be seen. 1. Know every man, woman, and child in the 15th district, except them that's been born this summer, and I know some of them, too. I know what they like and what they don't like, what they are strong at and what they are weak in, and I reach them by approaching at the right side. For instance, here's how I gather in the young men. I hear of a young feller that's proud of his voice, thinks he can sing fine. I ask him to come round to Washington Hall and join our glee club. He comes and sings, and he's a follower of Plunkitt for life. Another young feller gains a reputation as a baseball player in a vacant lot. I bring him into our baseball club. That fixes him. You'll find him working for my ticket at the polls next election day. Then there's the fellow that likes rowing on the river, the young fellow that makes a name as a waltzer on his block, the young feller that's handy with his dukes. I rope them all in by giving them opportunities to show themselves off. I don't trouble them with political arguments. I just study human nature and act accordin'. But you may say this game won't work with the high-toned fellers. The fellers that go through college and then join the Citizens Union? Of course it wouldn't work. I have a special treatment for them. I ain't like the patent medicine man that gives the same medicine for all diseases. The Citizens Union kind of a young man. I love him. He's the daintiest morsel of the lot, and he don't often escape me. Before telling you how I catch him, let me mention that before the election last year, the Citizens Union said they had 400 or 500 enrolled voters in my district. They had a lovely headquarters, too, beautiful roll-top desks and the cutest rugs in the world. If I was accused of having contributed to fix up the nest for them, I wouldn't deny it under oath. What do I mean by that? Never mind. You can guess from the sequel, if you're sharp. Well, election day came. The Citizens Union's candidate for senator, who ran against me, just polled 5 votes in the district, while I polled something more than 14,000 votes. What became of the 400 or 500 Citizens Union enrolled voters in my district? Some people guessed that many of them were good Plunkitt men all along and worked with the Cits just to bring them into the Plunkitt camp by election day. You can guess that way, too, if you want to. I never contradict stories about me, especially in hot weather. I just call your attention to the fact that on last election day, 395 Citizens Union enrolled voters in my district were missing and unaccounted for. I tell you frankly, though, how I have captured some of the Citizens Union young men. I have a plan that never fails. I watch the city record to see when there's civil service examinations for good things. Then I take my young Cit in hand, tell him all about the good thing, and get him worked up till he goes and takes an examination. I don't bother about him any more. It's a cinch that he comes back to me in a few days and asks to join Tammany Hall. Come over to Washington Hall some night, and I'll show you a list of names on our roll marked CS, which means bucked up against civil service. As to the older voters, I reach them too. No, I don't send them campaign literature. That's rot. People can get all the political stuff they want to read and a good deal more, too, in the papers. who read speeches nowadays, anyhow. It's bad enough to listen to them. You ain't going to gain any votes by stuffing the letterboxes with campaign documents. Like as not, you'll lose votes, for there's nothing a man hates more than to hear the letter carrier ring his bell and go to the letterbox expecting to find a letter he was looking for and find only a lot of printed politics. I met a man this very morning who told me he voted the Democratic state ticket last year just because the Republicans kept cramming his letterbox with campaign documents. What tells in holding your grip on your district is to go right down among the poor families and help them in the different ways they need help. I've got a regular system for this. If there's a fire in 9th, 10th, or 11th Avenue, for example, any hour of the day or night, I'm usually there with some of my election district captains as soon as the fire engines. If a family is burned out, I don't ask whether they are Republicans or Democrats, and I don't refer them to the charity organization society, which would investigate their case in a month or two and decide they were worthy of help about the time they are dead from starvation. I just get quarters for them, buy clothes for them if their clothes were burned up, and fix them up till they get things running again. It's philanthropy, but it's politics, too, mighty good politics. Who can tell how many votes one of these fires bring me? The poor are the most grateful people in the world, and let me tell you, they have more friends in their neighborhoods than the rich have in theirs. If there's a family in my district in want, I know it before the charitable societies do, and me and my men are first on the ground. I have a special corps to look up such cases. The consequence is that the poor look up to George W. Plunkitt as a father. Come to him in trouble and don't forget him on election day. Another thing, I can always get a job for a deserving man. I make it a point to keep on the track of jobs, and it seldom happens that I don't have a few up my sleeve ready for use. I know every big employer in the district and in the whole city, for that matter, and they ain't in the habit of saying no to me when I ask them for a job. And the children, the little roses of the district, do I forget them? Oh, no. They know me, every one of them, and they know that a sight of Uncle George and candy means the same thing. Some of them are the best kind of vote-getters. I'll tell you a case. Last year, a little 11th Avenue rosebud whose father is a Republican caught hold of his whiskers on election day and said she wouldn't let go till he'd promised to vote for me. And she didn't. End of chapter 6.